Okay, welcome everybody. OCD Mikey Hi-Fi Guy here. We're back Memorial Day 2021. And I'm going to go through the rig here because a lot of people ask, what is your rig all about? What's in there? What are you playing? What do you have? What's the equipment? All that kind of stuff. So I'm going to go through the rig now. And, you know, I changed little things out here and there. Now that I've settled on a lot of the main stuff, I'll go through and let you know, because this is my reference rig and it doesn't change. It stays the same. And then at little times I change things in and out, but this is the reference rig. So as it goes, it starts, just so you know, this is a panel that covers a window. Okay. Same with behind that curtain there. There's another same just like behind me. Okay. There's two windows. Okay. So this is something that just goes around the frame of the window. It goes right around the edge. We just pushed it on and it goes like right up tight against the casing. And it's a fabric. It's like, you know, 4 inches, 3 inches wide rock wool in there. And then a cover, some supporting braces and it prevents the, you know, windows from rattling or whatever, you know, bouncing back. Here is a tube trap. And this is, you can see right here, tell you which one it is. This is one I just got. This is not one that Art and I, you know, talked about and picked for this room. It's just one that I got from somebody traded. Gave it to me, actually, a pair of them. And so I just put them right here. I'm not sure that they're necessarily needed right there or whatever, but they seem to work fine. Okay, so the main speakers here are Analysis Audio. This is from Greece. Analysis Audio Amphitryon is the model. This is a 7-foot-tall, 200-pound planar magnetic panel, okay? So that means this thing's like a door, okay? It's about as wide as a door, you can see, and it goes, it reflects, or it sound comes out both sides, okay? It's called a dipole, that's what that means. And then we've got the tweeter. Actually, this is, I've modified these. This was the tweeter. I turned it into a mid-range, and then I use what I feel is a more proper tweeter, is the MagnaPan 60-inch ribbon tweeter. And then I also have up here is a super tweeter. That's from Townsend, and that's the super tweeter. So we've got highs are nice and crystal clear. Lows are very solid. This is the woofer part, not the sub. But normal planar magnetics do not have a rubber surround. This panel has a rubber surround, so it allows for further excursion. So you can play it louder, and it's more dynamic. And actually these would be great for just a big room. This room is we're shoehorning them into this room. They work phenomenal. But this is under special conditions that we made this work. Back there we got a holograph. It's these same guys. Shakti. Okay, so Shakti holograph. This sets up a little reflection point and resonation or reflection point. It broadens the vocal spectrum and widens the vocal in the image in the center. It makes it a little wider. Okay, here's my amps. These are my full-time amps. This is an AGD Vivace. That is a Class D gallium nitride. Beautiful unit there. That is a monoblock, and that is 100 watts at 8 ohms, and that thing powers my tweed, the ribbon tweeter here, and that ribbon tweeter goes from, let's see, like 2200 up, so 2200 to 20,000 hertz is all here, okay, so that's the biggest envelope of frequency we're leaving to the AGD to take care of the lion's share of the frequency. This is very, very articulate, very adept, very, very clear and clean, distortion free. It's the best for the highs, definitely. For the grunt department, we've got, and believe me, Jeff's amps are great. Full frequency, it does not matter, but this thing is a workhorse. It's beautiful. Like this is the, you know, this is all milled aluminum, heat sink and stuff. This is made in America. These are both made in America. Okay. Speakers are made in Greece. MagnaPans are made in America. And then these are made in America. The stands underneath are made in America. Those are Star Sound. This is an apprentice stand, but this guy knows what the hell he's doing. and it's brass cones and steel platforms, and they work really well. The cabling back there, all you see, that's Veristar. That's my creation. Those are my cables. That's what I do. My main hat is making foil cables. These things are not how people get them. I have them here on without the jacket. The people, when they buy them, get them with the jacket on there. But these are things that I pull in and out from prototyping different things and, you know, trying different things. So that's what the cables are. Again, this is a Roland 625S2. This is 325 watts per channel, and it's a two channel. So I use this for the woofer and the mid range. So Roland, we got Roland on the woofer and the mid, and then we got AGD Vivace on the tweeter here, as well as the super tweeter. Okay, right here we've got this is a subwoofer tower. I've got two of those, and this is from GR Research. He's got a kit that he sells with servo subs, and then this is an open H-frame type arrangement. So you can see back here, the front and the back is open. We've got one in the center. The woofer is reversed to equalize the pressure. Otherwise, all the pressure is going out the front, and I want to equalize it. So we put the center one forced going backwards, so it equalizes the pressure in the room better. And there you can see all the servo wires and stuff. It comes with a plate amp part of the kit. The greatest thing about this plate amp, I'm not too excited about plate amps, but these work really, really good because look at all the adjustment you have, even these little switches and stuff. You can tune the shit out of these things to make them perfect for your room. So they're excellent for that. I've had no complaints with these. They've gone over and above the duty. I had to make this cabinet, so I had my cabinet guys make this because the kit does not come with the cabinet. It's just the woofers in the amp, and then I put the Big John actually did these. They're neodymium magnets on the holding these grills on. Okay, and then the next part is the DAC. This is a Playback Designs MPD8 Dream DAC. This DAC here changed my whole listening experience. This thing did more for my system than any piece ever in 25 years of doing this. This thing changed my whole world around. I now enjoy music. Before, I was tweaking and way more tweaking the gear. I could not settle my brain down. All it did was judge and try and figure out what was wrong. This thing fixed it all. It's weird, but this guy invented the invented sample rate conversion. I have a sneaking suspicion that this guy has a theory about how sample rate conversion works with human physiology, because I'm telling you, nothing makes music feel the way this one does. It does something that is not heard, that that I feel for sure, and it changes the way that my thought patterns when I'm in here. I'm way more connected with the music. So as far as I'm concerned, Andreas comes from outer space, and he knows something about how this connects with the human heart and the human mind, the human brain, because this thing is life support for my rig. It makes or breaks the system. When it's out of here, I can't listen. When it's in there, I want to do nothing but listen. So I can't stress how important this piece is for the rig and for anybody's rig. Anytime if somebody comes to me and I'm setting them up on a rig, I know what I'm starting with, and I'm starting with this piece because I can guarantee that when I start with this piece, I'm going to have success in a wicked system that's going to blow their mind. So over here is my analog section. Okay, this will be put somewhere else. I'm going to get rid of this rack. This is also a Star Sound rack. Very important to the Sonic. This is a Star Sound. These are up, you can see down here, they're up on brass cones. Now these are, it's a special alloy of brass that Robert spent a lot of time developing, and the drains, it's what this is it's a mechanical ground, okay? So there's micro vibration in the whole room here, and this drains micro vibration. It grounds it to the ground and brings it down, pulls it out of the gear, brings it down. It is, it sounds like crazy, like, God, how much vibration could that really affect stuff? You wouldn't believe how much it affects stuff. It's unbelievable. That is a very, very strong thing. It's hard. It's one of those things that people overlook, and when you try and explain it, it doesn't make sense. Even to me, when Robert was explaining it to me, I'm like, yeah, right. You know, because they're expensive, you know, but you get what you pay for. This thing also transformed my rig. It was a combination of things over this last year that turned this rig into clearly a world-class rig without any question. Okay, so this bronze pasta bowl thing here is a PMR oh man, what do they call it? Novum, high-end Novum PMR Mark II. This thing is, and it sits a little loose, like on its thing. It's not cranked down. You know, you can see I can move it and stuff. It's I call it the pasta bowl. Okay, it's way thicker than a cymbal, but it is hand cast out of bronze, a bell bronze, which is the most resonant metal. And this thing picks up resonance, and it resonates with vocals. Really, what I found that it does right in the middle here is it gives me it supports the vocal harmonics, so I get a more natural vocal sound. It's very natural. You'd think, oh wow, it's metallic, it's going to make a metallic sound. Not at all. It supports the vocals, and it's a freaking amazing piece. Again, this is, now we're into the tweaks. They're $2,500. It's, you know, I mean, I traded a client for some of my cables. And I was so glad that he did that, because it was the coolest thing that I wanted to try. But it's one of those things that you don't, you know, it's like I didn't really want to spend the money to determine if I liked it or not. But so the trade was perfect. So I don't use a preamp. That's my preamp. That is no longer used. This is a Nat Audio Magnetostat SE. That is a world-class level. Some consider the best preamp line stage out. And you can compare it to any of them, it doesn't matter, you know. The Cat, the Wavac, people compare it to the best that there is, and it holds its own for sure, and many people choose the Nat because of its price point. That thing's only $23,000. It's going up against $50,000, $60,000 line stages. Here is the analog section here, I skipped over it kind of, is my reel-to-reel. Okay, this is a Otari MX5050 Mark III. The Mark III handled the tape a little gentler. It was much nicer. This was a machine that was never in commercial use. Somebody had it, bought it for home, and had been using it at home. The guy was a technician, an electronics technician. So this thing was absolutely pristine. I've never seen such a good example of this machine. And it's killer, man. Now, this plays back master tapes that I have. I have a whole collection of master tapes, include just all sorts of stuff. And we will get into that later. I have not even touched on the analog tape part because we're so busy with other things, but we will come to analog tape, and you will hear that and see how much better than vinyl it is. It crushes vinyl. Here are a couple pieces that are just outboard pieces that's an EQ, a Bax EQ, which is a from Dangerous Music. That's on top. I recommend that to any person that has a tape player. That thing is an amazing EQ that really can sweeten up the tape and get it just to where you want it, depending on how the tape is. Underneath was something I took on trade. That, I can't remember the name. This is a kind of a piece that came from Pro Audio. It was $2,500 in Pro Audio. Somebody took it. I won't say their name, but they took it, rebranded it, just put a faceplate with their name on it, and sold it into Hi-Fi for $4,500. I took it in on trade. I found out who it was by looking on the boards, and we sort of exposed this whole hustle, which is sad. I can't stand it when they do that, but I would have rather bought it from the guys. I didn't buy it, actually. I traded it, again, another trade piece, but I would rather have on the front the name of the original guys that make it. It's on the boards on the inside, and you can still pick those up for $2,500. It's a cool piece. This is just kind of like it's almost like a mic pre. You can add all this crap, and this is all kind of like, I call it, it's like fruity duty stuff. It's like just fluff. It's total just, it adds, it's totally additive. It adds all this crap, all these just things, sounds and crap and whatever. You can pull them in, pull them out, you know. I mean, look at the things they're called. It's called aggression, you know, low, mid, highs. And they got air and trim and just all this different shit. They renamed it for hi-fi. It's interesting piece. You can really manipulate the sound, totally. But that is something that we stay away from usually in hi-fi. It's kind of interesting to have on tape because, and it's an analog piece. So when you put it with tape and analog, it just has a different whole thing than if you try and use it in a digital rig. I don't think it's got a place in a digital rig. But in an analog rig, it is kind of interesting and it is kind of fun. So I have it there to play with. Okay, right over here is the server that I use all the time. This one is right here. This is one that I made using an HD Plex case. I polished that front with a polisher and a grinder, took it down, took off the black anodized. You can see the black anodized all around the edge. I took it off the face and I did my own polish on it. I've got the JCAT output card in there, the USB output, and then a power supply on that. With that, I use this Playback Designs. This is also from the company that makes the DAC. This is a digital interface. You can do a bunch of things with this. You can use it to record DSD. This is a pure DSD recorder. This the guy who designed this, not only did he invent sample rate conversion, he also invented or carried out the development of DSD for Sony when it was SACD, but it's the same single bit type thing. And so he also created the Sonoma recording suite, which is still the only recording suite where you can mix in DSD without conversion to PCM. So when people tell you, oh, all DSD is lame because you have to convert it to PCM to mix, well, no, you don't. If you have a Sony Sonoma setup, then you are stoked because you can mix in native DSD. Down here is just a power supply. These are really just different power supplies to power the audio card, and then the switch, which is back there. Back here I've got more Veristar. I don't know if you can even see them really. Veristar cables and power strips. Oh yeah, over here, Puritan conditioner. This is an AC power conditioner. Forgot about that. Down here, Puritan AC power conditioner, 156. That is cleans up the AC power coming in from the wall, which is dirty. You have AC power always has noise on it unless you've cleaned it up. Now this is all snake mess. This will be cleaned up, routed. Everything will be nicely organized and clean after I'm done figuring out what shit I'm going to keep and what I'm not and what I'm going to put where. So again, we've got the other sub tower here. We got the other Roland 625S2 AGD Vivace on this side carrying up the duty. Again, a holograph. These are from GK Audio. I always get GR Research from Danny and Glenn's company mixed up, but this is an Atlanta company that makes acoustical panels and stuff. Okay, so that is that. And that's the rig. This is all stuff that I pull in and out and I can play with. I've got tube amps. This is an 805 amp from Nat. This is a Western Electric 91A clone amp using a killer toroid back there, which you don't normally see on these amps, but you should hear the balls on this thing. And 8 watts, and incredible. Here's the APL, my old reference. There's a Wadia killer DAC from like way back when. And man, some of these old DACs were so sweet. If you can find one of these, I think I paid $300 for it. It'll blow away like 90% of the DACs that you find for under, $1,000 or around $1,000, $1,500 nowadays. Here's the APL Hi-Fi DSD MR. It's a DSD M box, but it's all MR guts inside there. The Rockna, which is another reference of mine, the Rockna Wave Dream Signature Balanced. This is a R2R DAC extraordinaire. We got that. There's the old crossovers for the analysis speakers. That's a Crayon. We listened to that integrated a little while ago. Here's the AudioByte Vox and the Zap DAC. That's a power supply and a DAC. And then the Dangerous Music Source, which is a killer DAC for $1,000, made in USA. Canary Audio. I took these on trade. I don't even know what I'm going to do with them. These are also 300B amps and 8 watts and I think I'll probably modify them, listen to them, and sell them. I don't plan on keeping them. Here's Kinky Studio preamp. I have that thing just left over from when I distributed that stuff. So anybody want a preamp, I've got one here at a good price. This is the Allo Audio stuff. Here is Stello from Korea. Stello is a killer brand. The guy's got great ears. Simon Lee from Korea. Right up there is an Aesthetics. You can barely see it. It's an Aesthetics Romulus, which is a killer DAC with a transport on it. Over there is a TIAC. I just got a bunch of stuff. This is the Bridge Audio Labs, that one Japanese $30,000 DAC. It's really killer, made by the guy that used to the top tech at Luxman. Here's some more Jeff Rowland stuff. We've got 125 pair of 125s and a 535. We've got a Cause Engineering D1 a DAC here. Here we've got, this is a killer Class A Coda. 50 watts per channel, one of my favorite amps. I love this little thing, man. It is just a monster of current, a little pig. I just love this thing. It's killer and fun. You put that on something like these, Pure Audio Project Trio 15s, and it's just going to completely command control of that speaker. Instead of having the Voxative, I have the AERs, which I got on my own. The AER is the originator. Voxative is a knockoff of an AER. And that's just the fun stuff, whatever. That's in and out. But this is, I went through the main rig with you. These are Audions. These are the AGD Audions that are right here. These things are killer monoblocks. I could also use those on the tweeters if I wanted. But I think I pretty much got the whole rig there. Here's my tripod that I use to make the things. So let's test it out now that I've shown you and whet your appetite with that. Let's play a little, see if you recognize this tune from the Pink Floyd band that I love. And it's a cover. Take it away. Come on, let's make up a tall tale. Sweat and waste the hours in our head waiting. Kicking around on a piece of ground in your hometown. Waiting for someone or something to show you. That's over driving the microphones, but I don't know if you could hear that or not, if there's like a reduction or something on here, but oh yeah, here we go. Here's, try the Omni mics here. I'll go back up in a second. This now, that was, I can't remember if that was forward or on. Now I got Omni mics on, but 105 dB, 106, you saw it 107, it was peaking up there. Tell me a rig that can, you know, I mean, just put the dB meter on your damn rig. See if you can even get it over 100. And be careful, because you'll blow shit up. I'm not kidding, man. It's hard to do what I just did. Especially on, you know, well, it's just hard to do. Try it, and you'll see what I mean. I've got everything C-weighted and slow on the dB meter, you know. So right now we're at, you know, right around 96, 80-something. Okay, and now let's bring her up. These microphones set up a little different here. The end of the song? Oh yeah, that's the end. That's the end of the song. Let me bring it back and we'll do it again. 10 years ago. You missed the starting girl. Your rig does not hammer like that. Forget about it. Somebody, give me some, anybody, give me a recording that shows 108 dB just standing there. Like, I mean, that last little punch there was sick, dude. That will break most people's shit. I might have broken my shit. Let's listen. See if we broke anything. Dude, if you were in here, you would have just shit your pants. I mean, that is like fireworks are going off here. It's like boom, boom, boom. Those bass subwoofers were ready to just fall out onto the floor, man. I need bigger woofers. Wow. Oh, that was the shit, man. That was crazy. I don't recommend you do that at home because you're going to break something. It's going to cost you money. And this is not cheap shit. Okay, well, I'm still bewildered by... I was actually trying to turn it down right there, and I pressed the wrong button. And it went up. And I, oh, shit! But I had to leave it there for a couple seconds. You probably saw my arm wiggling and shit, like, oh, shit! It went the wrong way! But it held together, man. I'm telling you, Danny's subs were ready to explode. But they held together. I don't know how much longer they would have held together at that level there, but that was something to beheld. Holy crap. It was like bazookas were going off in here. Boom, 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 boom. Those subs were like, holy shit. Oh my God. That's crazy. All right, you guys. See you. Okay, guys. I just wanted to say something after that. Do not try that at home. Also, another thing too is hi-fi is not about how loud can we get it, okay? The reason that I do this is because the nuance part of what hi-fi is very hard to show you on YouTube. There's things that the depth of the image, the realism, the lucidity of it, the density, a lot of these things, the nuance, the little things are experienced in the room. They're not going to show up on YouTube. How am I going to show you how good the imaging is on YouTube? One thing I can do on YouTube is show you how clean the system can play at 110, you know, decibels. That is a very loud, very loud. We were just up at 108, solid 108. It went up to like 113. I think it was peaking at 113 and stuff. So if you just look at the dB meter and that last little bit where I like freaked out and put it back up there, those were the peaks that were hitting. Your system has got to be extremely well made to be able to handle that like that, especially like what I just did, a mistake where I went the wrong way with the volume and it went up and held together. Everything held together. It sounded like it was incredible. The subs sounded like they were just bazookas. I'm not kidding, man. It was just like explosions going off in here, but it was wicked. And then we turned it down. Nothing, no problem. Turn it back up a little bit and it's beautiful. Nothing was damaged. Okay. It takes a hell of a system, a world-class rig to be able to play like that with those types of drums that were going off and all that hard rock stuff at that sort of a volume. You just can't do it. Your system has to be completely sorted and of extremely high quality to be able to play that clean with no distortion. I mean, we went all the way up into 118 peak with not a hint of any sort of distortion. We're still hearing everything totally clear, the drums, the vocals, everything, no problem. So that's why I show you the volume, because it's pretty much the only thing that I can prove to you is happening. Okay. Everything else, you can kind of compare things, one thing to another, but with a dB meter and playing it back, you can hear, holy shit, he is playing it at 118 or 113, and nothing's breaking, and it still sounds clear, and it's, you know, it's not smoking or on fire, and didn't blow the breaker or whatever. So, you know, that's proof right there. Anybody else doing hi-fi tests, want to really prove something, put your dB meter out in front of the camera there and turn your shit up and let's see where it lands and see how high you can go before something breaks. I really don't recommend you go until it breaks, but see if you can get it up to, you know, 100. See if you can even get it over 100 or around 100. Again, it's not something that you strive for. I never listen to it that loud, ever. It's just something to show you guys this sort of a situation where I'm trying to show you how good a system is over YouTube, which is, you know, nearly impossible. But there's proof with what I just did. That proves how loud it can play and how clean it can play at that loudness and recover without a problem, okay? That alone is a testament to the quality of a system, just that it can do that. So I understand when I'm not trying to say, play it all the time like that, you know, or whatever, because I don't. I play probably around like 80 to 90 dB when I'm listening, probably closer to 80. And that's all that's needed, and it sounds great. Even less than that, you play at 60, and you just get beautiful nuance and whatever. I can get these incredible things, but I can't show you that through YouTube. You have to come and listen, so, or just buy a rig. I'll set you up. Anyway, so that's it, and I will see you. Bye.